everybody. This is Michael C. Rupert, Tracker of Truth, with you again on the 1st of December, 2013. We made it this far, yeah. Huge show tonight, but got to share some things up front before we bring on Patrick Penry, Tony Muga. Yeah. I've been snowed in for 6 days. I got my car out yesterday. Snowed in meaning almost no human contact for 6 days, which was a vision quest all by itself. I'm asking the cold to teach me lessons this winter. From what I hear from the locals who have lived here for a long time, search and rescue guys, it looks like I'm going to be hitting 40 and 50 below. So I'm looking into things like silk sock liners and insulated coveralls, and I'm taking lessons from the people who know. This makes you pay attention. I'm asking the cold to be a teacher to me this winter. We need there's something very important happening tomorrow, and you guys have to please find any way to support. The Elsipetag and Mi'kmaq peoples who have fought successfully in New Brunswick to stop fracking on sovereign native lands are back at it again because the powers that were, of course, don't give up. Canadian government has said clearly it's working on behalf of and executing the word of the Queen of England in bringing the fracking trucks back onto the land. And these brave warriors are out doing it again. They're doing roadblocks tomorrow. They have called for an urgently worldwide for support people to show up and show support in any way possible. I would encourage you to do that. You can find out everything you need to know by going to lastrealindians.com, lastrealindians.com. They are fighting for all of us. They're fighting for all life. And they're fighting the Queen of England. And for all of you who have followed all this and wonder who the heads of the old paradigm are, I don't know many or any names higher on the list. And they're taking her on, and they're taking that concept on, and they've won. You need to support them. Tomorrow's the day. Check it out, please. Okay, so before we get into what we're going into tonight, I want to set a theme for what we're doing because I really understand that there's a lot on the line tonight. There is a lot being discussed, and perhaps most of the anti-nuclear movement is listening because they're wondering how to process a whole lot of things in a world. They're trying to make sense out of a world full of nonsense, and that's what we're here to do tonight. But this is very important, and this is going to set a tone. There was a thread on my Facebook page that's going to apply tonight to how we approach people who we have looked to for information. And the thread was actually about the Pope, Pope Francis, who has been making some really excellent statements about money that signal huge shifts in the position of the Catholic Church, and I read one recently, and I was pretty impressed with the words, and I felt some sincerity there, but it triggered a good discussion. And I wrote, I have to say, this is on Facebook, that I welcome and encourage the Pope's statements. I'm not forgetting the Church's history. I'm not ignoring it. It's not that I suddenly trust the Church, but if we rule out the possibility of awakening those who have been blind or even enemies, then we close the possibility to that door for ourselves. I believe that the correct approach is to accept without ridicule any new stated positions and encourage further movement towards the truth. It's easy to sit back and just condemn everything. That's easy to condemn, but the end result is that we will still wind up powerless, fragmented, and alone. And you know, some of the comments were, if the deeds match the sentiment, then awesome. And love thy enemy is all about being open to reconciliation. In my book, reconciliation means only after a change has come from the perpetrator, the one who is changing their lives. Someone else respectfully disagreed. Actions are what count. The Catholic Church wants to make amends or recompense, and it should begin by redistributing its massive, sometimes criminally acquired wealth. It isn't tiresome and hypocritical when someone or some entity says, I'll do it as long as everyone else does it too. The Church is concentrated power. The Pope is one man with one opinion. Those are nice sentiments. A lot of skepticism, but there was a lot of anger toward the Church and a lot of demand for retribution. So, and I responded, so you think it's better if the world's 3 billion Catholics hear and ponder a different message, like the one the Church always carried? You know, these are drastically different words, and they're issued as encyclicals or papal statements, and Catholics read them, and they take them to heart. they, like us, are individuals with their own consciousness. So how has the mainstream media controlled us? They did so by feeding us bad messages, if good messages are coming out. But this is leading to a deeper point. Someone then a poster said, "Lead by example. You know, you just don't talk it, walk it. Start giving your wealth back. Start dismantling your vast ownership." And then I said, "You know, I wrote back. If we're going to lead people out of enslaved consciousness, we lead them with baby steps. If the church is having an awakening, and my job as a scout is to see that those who are capable of having one have one." And I said, you know, you lead people out of enslaved consciousness, you lead with baby steps. You hit them with the full truth right away and hold them to standards that we have arrived at through years or decades of painful personal growth and work, and they'll run away. That's a very, very important for our subject matter tonight. Newborn consciousness needs to be fed breast milk. A steak dinner with baked potatoes and apple pie will kill it. And this poster came back, man, but we need to go in and redistribute the wealth. You know, it's like, and I wrote, "Hey, man." You know, and then I responded in 12-step recovery, which we've talked about a lot here. Making amends is the ninth step. There are eight which come before, which go along with the change of consciousness that must be completed before restitution. Your anger puts you in a place of wanting pure fantasy to legislate these acts through the mechanisms of the old paradigm. You know, swords and axes, go take the church's money, make them do it, beat them, what? That only reinforces a selfish urge and engenders resentment in those who are just awakening, might be taking the right steps. Somebody gets it. Another commenter, the tide is definitely turning. Just the fact that Pope Francis has not suddenly died like Pope John Paul I did after 33 days, I remember that, says tons about the lack of cohesiveness of the darkest groups inside the city-state. Remember that the Pope also went after the Institute of Religious Works, a.k.a. Vatican Bank. I agree with MCR. Our longing for a quick and swift consciousness shift can and has hurt the awakening of many. And it went back and forth. And again, the demand came, the Catholic Church must redemand it. So I don't like them. I'm Elizabeth. I said that in my response, then help the Catholic Church work the first eight steps with encouragement, support, and without condemnation. Don't try and force them when they aren't there yet. And so basically what this came down to, well, I made a statement that says, it is our most sacred obligation to hold open, as spiritual warriors, warrior of light, to hold open and safe the space which we want our fellow humans to enter and occupy so that all who are truly willing to change can enter with us. The fundamental issue is not for us to decide. The fundamental issue is whether the expressed willingness is sincere or not. If the willingness is sincere, it will be followed by action. If it isn't, there's nothing we can do about it. If the ones who are unwilling to change or who are insincere liars, who are enemies, we don't waste a moment of time on them, except at some point to remove them. Sacred, to hold open the possibility of change of consciousness without calling people names or judging them. That's just a critical point that I want to make tonight. There are certainly those who would continue to lie and deceive us. They are shills. They are liars. They are active, knowledgeable, willing agents of untruth, of evil, of lying, of darkness. And the ones who are not willing to change, those are the ones when the time comes we draw our swords against with a fury. Been waiting for that for a long time. So that's the point. And so what I want to open this show tonight with Patrick Penry, a.k.a. Tony Muga. I'm going to like to say that name. I don't know. Tony Muga. I just want to say it. Is that Arne Gundersen, Helen Caldicott, I'm not coming after you. You have served us enormously. You have taught us. You have helped us to understand what's going on. And there are so many other people. I'm not signaling you out. There are certainly press agencies and shills and TEPCO and people that have lied and spread bad truth, but not everybody is a shill. And the door is wide open. I wrote Arne Gundersen an open letter, which I read on the show 2 weeks ago. He has not responded. I wish he would. I really wish he would. I wish Chris Busby or Helen, who I love. She's been a guest on the show. A wonderful heart, wonderful passion, very eloquent, would step up and address these things because we got something very important to talk about. And what we're talking about is a series of a collection of documents that, by legal standards, have greater and more probative value than any newspaper article or any statement, any press release that has thus far been issued with regards to the conditions at Fukushima Daiichi reactor complex on the east coast of Japan. These are documents that were obtained through a Freedom of Information Act request that were sent in an envelope by the U.S. government, the NRC, Nuclear Regulatory Commission, with the stamp and seal of a court reporter notary who prepared the transcription and certified it as authentic. So really, in a sense, my guest tonight, Patrick Penry, who is on the line right now, is absolutely irrelevant. What he's done is to have the courage, the intelligence, to recognize the importance of these documents and work like a maniac to get people to pay attention to them. In that, we have discovered that he's a really capable video producer. He's a musician. He can narrate. He's a teacher. He's a scout. Tony, welcome to the Lifeboat Hour, man.
Well, Mike, it's an honor and a privilege, and again, I remembered to call you Mike. I'll try not to call you Sir or Mr. Rupert tonight. And I appreciate the lead-in, and, you know, I agree with everything you say. Like we talked before, I mentioned I'm studying the precepts of Zen Buddhism. I'm a practicing Christian, but like I'm like you, I'll draw from anything, from anywhere, if it makes sense, and that's kind of what I'm, you know, the tact I'm taking, the direction I'm taking now is I want to be a little more open to people and just more easy on people and just try to unify and bring people in to the information and warm them up to the information. Like you said, it's a lot of information.
Yeah.
It's a lot to take in, a lot to digest. So it's not fair of me to expect people to know this intimately overnight. So.
Yeah. But you know, I can certainly understand also the sense of urgency and the power, because I have made a life career off of document analysis and learning how to not only read them, but to give them probative value and analyze them and to stand up and shout the message that they carry. So, that being said, tell us the history. These are documents released under the Freedom of Information Act. Who asked for them? When? When were they sent? When did they arrive? Where can people look at these? Because I want the listeners tonight to whoop out a pencil so they can actually go look at some of these documents with us. Tell us that story real quick.
Well, first of all, it's very easy to find the documents. If you just type Nuclear Regulatory Commission, NRC, they have a website, and the bulk of these documents are contained at that website. And all my videos and my book, Something Wicked This Way Comes, I link to the NRC website because you can always go there. It's a vast collection of documents. I don't deny it. It may be literally millions of pages, and it's a pain in the butt to go through. Tonight, I'll provide you guys some links. I hope you got my email with the links in there in case people want to check these documents.
Well, you have a website, hatrickpenry.wordpress.com. That's Patrick Henry. Play Pig Latin with it. hatrickpenry.wordpress.com. Now, okay, quick questions. Who originally requested these documents? Is it a person? Is it a human being?
Okay, good question. Originally, the Associated Press, Friends of the Earth, there were a number of media outlets or groups, environmental-type groups, that were filing for, paying for particular transcripts. They would say, I want the telephone transcripts of this day or this particular conversation, mm-hmm. and they try to be direct when you do it that way. All these, anyone can look them up, but when you go on a Freedom of Information, at least my understanding is, you're kind of paying for them to sift through and give you specific documents of a time or date or place or particular people.
How did these documents get into your hand? That's what I want to know. Did you find them yourself? Did someone else do it? You heard about it from somebody else? How did I have to establish chain of custody?
The initial flow went like this. My mom cued me into what was going on. She had been to Informable.com, Lucas Hickson's site where she had read some documentation. I think Joy Thompson was a writer there back in the day that had a really good initial article. So from some documents there, my mom came to me and said, look, this is a big thing. You need to look into this. And that's how it was initially brought to my attention.
Okay, that's good. That's what I want to know. So these documents are all available just with a few clicks. I know the links have been up on my Facebook page to where people have actually downloaded many hundreds of pages of documents that are on file. Somebody found complete transcripts of telephone conference calls in the days immediately following the earthquake and tsunami. Who found those, and were they easy to find?
Which are you talking about, specific documents here, or just in general? Initially, the earliest you could get your hands on these documents was late July or early June of 2011. Mm-hmm. That's when they initially came out. Within 60 days, Mike, you had some documentation come out that really shed light on this massive cover-up of the plume and cloud and fallout and what have you. So within 60 days, you have some really damaging evidence that was publicly available. 90%, I'm told, of the freedom of information was sought after by the Associated Press. So they were the really big players who really wanted to go in and get as much as they could.
So the bottom line is, once they became available within a few months after 3/11/11, then people actually started looking at them and saying, oh, wait a minute, there's some serious stuff in here. Is that about right?
Yes, but I would say on a very small scale, there's people interested in these documents. I'm sure you're aware of E&E News. They hosted some of these documents and some information I got from there to send me deeper and explore further, because some people would just kind of touch upon them, whereas I wanted to really go in depth and get the meat, the substance of what was in these documents, try to digest them, and then try to, in a simple format, put it out there in layman's terms for everybody to understand.
Okay, all right. Now we've got to move along past this, because we want to get into what the documents actually say. Yeah. Many of these documents were telephone transcripts of involving people like the chairman of the NRC, then Gregory Jasko, a guy named Chuck Castro, who you found to be consistent, male participant, a lot of other names in there, and there was also some redaction. So I want to make sure we're talking about the same set of documents, because I'm looking at one with page number 137 on it that says, this is going to progress to the point, this is Chairman Jasko, at which we probably have, we think, I have to assume at this point that we're going to have three reactors out of control and possibly up to six spent fuel pools. Male participant, agreed. I think we need to take whatever actions are necessary to deal with that. Now, this is just one of many documents, but I'm going to ask you in a second just to give some very short quotes, because we have to budget our time very carefully here.
Yes.
Tonight. That it is a given from at least four or five different points that the spent fuel pool at reactor number four was completely combusted. There was nothing left of it. All the fuel was gone. Same thing with number three. Deep questions about two and one, but three meltdowns. And this completely contradicts anything that we have been told officially or even by people like Arne Gunderson. And I wish he would respond, because, you know, he just, I pray to God he will. But, so, very bad conditions. Now, we're 20 minutes after the hour. Really intense here, and I got everybody listening. All right, let's do a couple of minutes here, and then I'm going to play a song. And this is one of the ways that I introduce my guests to my family here, is that the music that we pick reveals what's in our heart. And Tony is also a very accomplished musician and songwriter, singer. We will get there in a minute, because we can read Cartesian science can't measure heart, but music and art sure do. Okay, before we go to the song, which you're going to tell us about, read us a couple of other quotes that are very in-your-face clear. Can you do that?
Okay, I'm pulling from the document that talks about the walls being blown out on Unit 4, and this is John Moniger. He's an NRC official who is embedded with TEPCO and government in Japan. He was very close proximity to what was really going on. And he says, Unit 1 and 2 is boiling down. Unit 3 and 4 is having Zirk water reaction. They believe there is essentially no walls on Unit 3. Unit 4. The explosion leveled the walls, leveled the structure for the Unit 4 spent fuel pool all the way down to the approximate level of the bottom of the fuel. So there's no water in there whatsoever. Male participant. And no ability to retain water. John Moniger. And no ability to retain water. And that one, again, I'm not going to – you just read one from that document. I'm not going to beat the dead horse on that one. There's plenty of discussion of walls blown out, so on and so forth. But later in that document, page 421, you have a discussion between then-Chairman Jaksko, Elliot Brenner, head of Office of Public Affairs for the NRC, and Chuck Casto, who I still have a pretty good opinion of Chuck Casto out of all these characters. And here the discussion goes thus. This is in regards to their already stated position of this day, which is March 16th, is this document. This is in reference to their already stated position, Jaksko, on Unit 4 being dry. He's already said this. And so Elliot Brenner says, Mr. Chairman, Jaksko says, yes. Elliot says, I'm not hearing anything to suggest we should be rolling back tonight, correct? That means rolling back our statement is what he's referring to. Jaksko, yes, yes, that's correct. Elliot, thank you. Jaksko, anything else you want to add? Elliot, no, no. Jaksko, I mean, Chuck, let me ask you that. Do you think I need to roll back any of the statements that I made? Chuck Casto, I don't. I don't think so. You know, we've gone over it. It may not have been dry, but it certainly wasn't full. With the steam on it, it's inconclusive of where the water level is on Unit 4. Jaksko, okay. Casto, I think is the best. Jaksko, okay. Casto, or on Unit 3, certainly on Unit 3. Jaksko, okay. Casto, and without mitigating actions, without adding water to that spent fuel pool, it's, you know, Jaksko, it will be dry. Casto, you lose water. And that's really indicative of them saying, look, we're darn certain of this. We're certain enough we're not going to roll back that statement. It is what it is. Now, later, as we all suspect, phone calls are made, pressure is applied, and the story changes, as it often does in these cover-ups, as you well know about that. So that little, those two parts right there kind of very revealing.
There were other spots where it was stated unequivocally, and I'm going to make a statement about that in a second, that the all of the fuel in the spent fuel pool 4 had been consumed, and there was one statement where it said it was just in a pile on the floor, that there were no walls left. And what I want to note with this, as I read these, and I encourage everybody in the audience to go to these sites, and we'll give them out again. Read the documents for yourselves. That's your obligation. That not once in any of these transcripts that carry the weight, legal weight of depositions in court. That's why they have more probative value than anything else that I have seen so far. Plus, they match physical reality that we know about better. But never once did I hear any of these participants equivocate. I didn't hear people saying, "Oh, well, Unit 4 might SFP 4 might have melted down." And I come from a government family, and I've, you know, been in high-level briefings at LAPD and Congress and, you know, a lot of places. You never exaggerate. You never make absolute statements unless you know that what you're saying to your higher-ups is true and correct because they're making decisions on what you report. Okay, now, whether we're ready or not, I want to play your song. We're into this. We're all in one side of our being or one side of our body. But music is essential, and it's a way of bringing all of a human being into this place. Tony, you're a singer-songwriter. You wrote this song. Tell us about it in 10 seconds or less, and then we're going to play it.
Well, in 10 seconds or less, it talks about the state of nuclear power, the big lie, nuclear power. And the middle section of the song is like a tribute to my love for the Japanese people.
And what's it called?
It's called Nuclear Reality.
Nuclear Reality by Tony Muga. Let's listen.
Dirty and greasy, low down and skeezy, exposing admin are risking our lives. One more meltdown, our president is southbound, the blue's rising up to the sky. And like little ants, we build more nuclear plants, ignoring the red traffic light.
Good. Tony, where can people hear your music?
You can catch me on YouTube. I've got a playlist on YouTube, and I've got a couple on SoundCloud. I'm trying to build get some songs online. YouTube's the best place to go, and I've got a playlist there you can listen to all. I've got 6 or 7 originals online right now.
What did you play on that track?
I do everything. I play bass guitar. I do lead, rhythm guitar, all vocals. I program drums. I write. I record. I do the mixing, the engineering. Kind of like Joe Satriani, only I actually sing and have a good voice. You know,
kinda
like to think I do.
Yeah, well, no, that was a great song, man. You remind me a lot of my bandmate Doug Lewis, who I miss so severely. He's out in Northern Cal with Squishy Rags' best friend. Long story. We are at the bottom of the hour. This is Michael C. Rupert, Tracker of Truth, here on the Lifeboat Hour on the Progressive Radio Network. We are rolling without a break tonight. We're just going to roll right through because this is a pretty important show. We have some actually emotionally charged, powerful points to make, and that energy is present, and the music kind of settles us down. You know, tell the drummer it's in G. I need to do some fundraising thank yous for all the great messages. I do what I do for free. I'm getting by okay now. I've given out the address. I'm not going to give that out tonight. I'm okay for the minute. But I have some great thank yous. And there's some great presents coming to Brad, Aurelius Daniel, he sent me his book, a huge book, A Big History of Music, with a wonderful letter in there. And that's since it's going to be 40, 50 below, and I'm going to be spending a lot of time indoors this winter, I think I'm going to get to that. Thank you. To Frank Damiano, Grandma Coco, I love you. Joyce Katzberg sent me some great music. She's also a great singer-songwriter. To Chana Maumi, from Birmingham, England, my dear friend who sent me this great sweater from England. And thanks to all of you. I'm getting so many messages of love right now and support from all the people who are my tribal friends, all the people who know how we take care of each other. And I am introducing Tony into our circle tonight. I'm sure that you're already figuring out that he's a pretty cool guy. All right, Tony, when some of the things that had really been bothering me about Fukushima, aside from everything, was I kept hearing references to getting to the spent fuel pool at Reactor 3. And I even think I heard Arnie Gunderson himself refer to that once. But certainly that's the official line. Now, we have the NRC documents, which say clearly that they know spent fuel pool at 3. Forget about it. It's gone. And you can look at a photograph. You can look at the multitude of photographs of Unit 3. And see that there aren't any upper floors, and they're GE Mark I reactors, and the spent fuel pools in all of them are like four or five floors, six floors up above the ground, and there are no upper floors because of the explosion there. So I'm wondering, well, where is the spent fuel pool? That doesn't compute, and that's what really prompted me. And I apologize for not picking up on your stuff sooner, and I had to make amends for that to the people that I serve, and to my honor. You know, it's like you're my karmic payback. You release thousands of pages of documents. You turn out amazing videos. You're very prolific, and it took me a while for Spirit to kick me in the butt and say, you really need to look at this, and when I did, I corrected it immediately, because you are carrying a valuable message. That makes you a trusted scout, because you're carrying the truth that has nothing to do with who you are. But I have to say, too, that other things came up, and maybe you've learned some lessons with this. I know, you know, I have had expressed my opinions about Alex Jones many times, and we are not going to spend more than 20 seconds on Alex Jones. He doesn't deserve that kind of time. But you took these documents to Alex Jones, and he brushed you off. But there was another tactic that was also employed that people like Jones tried to put on me, is that they would take the great work I'd done, and then they would plant one or two steps beyond where I was with other theories, such as the earthquake of September 11th was a deliberately orchestrated man-made event, which can't be, and that's how they discredit us. Share with us your position on that, because I've seen it attached to you early on. What do you think about that?
As far as, you know, approaching Alex Jones
Well, no, we already know that Alex Jones brushed you off. That says enough. But what about the concept? Do you endorse a belief that 311 was a man-made deliberate event? And if so, who did it and with what motive?
Well, I would say this on that. I cannot prove beyond any reasonable doubt that it was a man-made event.
Right, okay.
That being said, what I try to concentrate on with these documents, and like we've discussed, is what I can prove, and what generally when you look at the documents, that's what grabs you in your feel and everything. So I've had this discussion with some of my associates that I work with, and we've back and forth, and in the end we settle and said, look, it doesn't really matter if it was a natural event or if, you know, there's some kind of conspiracy and they're using some kind of weapons we don't understand. The fact of the matter is we now know, and that we can't argue, that the possibility exists, because it's already happened once, that one of these facilities can have a massive, a catastrophic incident, regardless of how it was created. And that strikes to the fact that we just need to face reality and begin to decommission systematically all plants around the world as fast as possible, because okay, if they're not a terrorist target now, as technology advances and considering the mentality of humans on this planet, they will be eventually if they're not now. So
right.
I don't argue how it happened. It's like with 9/11. I've been caught up in that argument. I look at people, I say, you know it was an illegal war, right? If me and Michael Rupert hijack planes and fly them into buildings in Russia, Russia does not get to come and attack and occupy America. That's a criminal case.
But
really.
Here's
it should
the
be
big
pursued
point.
As much.
But here's the big point. With 9/11, there was a motive. Gain control of Iraqi oil.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and a whole bunch of other things.
Right.
There is no motive. There is no motive that applies to this because the whole human race's life is in the balance. There's no guarantee of anybody surviving, and there's nothing to gain. Who benefits? That's the one question that has to be answered when you're alleging a crime is who benefits. Nobody benefits from this if everybody dies.
Right, but what I can say in key, Bono, is that who benefits from the cover-up, and that is the nuclear industry and the arms industry and so on and so forth. So again, when I stick to the non-superficial aspect and I say, we know the accident happened, regardless of how it happened, we know there was a cover-up, let's concentrate on that provable cover-up and hold some people accountable, because if we don't, it's like with 9/11, how many years go by before you know justice will never be served 10 years later?
Yeah, and of course, I've taken the public position many, many times, and I still take it to this day, that it's futile to pursue 9/11. The difference still being is that Fukushima is an ongoing event, almost 3 years old, in which the dispersal of radiation hasn't stopped for one damn day.
Correct.
And the other point, the other problem with that, of course, is that all human life is in jeopardy, and that catastrophic amounts far beyond. Helen Callicott was a guest on the show. She said there were 10 Chernobyls in the spent fuel pool at 4, a total of, I think she said, 85 Chernobyls at all 6 fuel pools. We know that the fuel pool at reactor 3 contained super deadly MOX fuel. Now, if there is an attempt to conceal, and I have to repeat that as I look at these documents, Tony, none of these guys equivocate. They're making emphatic statements. You know, it's this fuel pool is gone. That's gone. This is burned. There's nothing that can be done. Great discussions about the need to evacuate, discussions about the military, and those match what we have since learned, thanks to people like Callicott and Arnie Gunderson, about how much radiation is there. So if they're going through with this charade, I conclude, and let me ask you if this is your conclusion as well, that the one thing they really don't want us to understand is how much radiation has already been released and what the ramifications are. Does that ring with you?
I agree 100%. And if you just do a thought experiment and think about things from the government to people in control standpoint, if Fukushima was the worst of the worst, 3 reactors, all the spent fuel pools are pretty close to it, and that much was released, they either lie about it and deceive us, okay, or there may be some levels of honesty or dishonesty, or they can be completely honest. Now, being completely honest, again, mm-hmm. that's just not logistically or realistically possible. And I write about this in Fear and Loathing on Fukushima Unit 4, where I say, considering the proximity, the magnitude of some of these catastrophes and these events, you can't move people quick enough out of the plume. In the case of Three Mile Island, I read FOIA documents on that too. They said, some guy says, you got to warn the people, there's a plume, you have to let them know. The guy says, look, by the time we can let those people know who are in the path of the plume will have moved from that location, and we may be moving them into the path of the plume. So there's no easy way. They could not tell the truth. And again, I look at the government, I say, if you're having angst about telling the truth in these things, I suggest you decommission and shut down systematically all nuclear plants. You won't have that problem. I don't have a definite alternative solution, but if we put free minds together and let them speak openly, like I like your stuff talking about the Indian elders and whatnot, I'd go to the Hopi Indians and ask them, how can we live? How can we make this work, you know?
Yes, yes. Well, we are getting close to my song, the one that I picked to play tonight. I don't think anybody would dispute at this point that if 3 reactors are gone, 1, 2, and 3, we know that those cores are gone. They've been discharging, venting. and three or possibly four reading the documents. It's not clear whether they're sure about reactor one's spent fuel pool or two's. But three spent fuel pools, all of that is enough radiation to threaten all of human life on the planet already. And, you know, we see these great postings on Facebook, and, these are not just somebody writing them. These are news stories documenting really horrendous spikes in radiation all over the world. Plus, we have the massive die-offs of starfish, of bluefin tuna. I mean, it's a huge, long list. Polar bears, 20% of the polar bears, skin lesions, so on and so forth. That's a lot of radiation out there. And as human beings, we deserve the right, we have the right to know what's going on here. And that's a fundamental human right. And this is where the truth is more important to our humanity than anything else right now. So now I'm going to play my song. Now, I picked a song tonight. We've played some amazing songs, Jackson Browne, Joni Mitchell, a whole lot of songs and newer ones that were just so exceptionally prophetic in describing the times that we live in now. And I picked a song that may be one of, if not the most prophetic song of all. And it was by a guy named Paul Simon and a guy named Art Garfunkel. And it was called Sound of Silence. And this was recorded in Central Park in New York in the late 90s, I think it was. And here it is, Sound of Silence. Simon and Garfunkel, Sound of Silence. And we cannot afford to be silent now. We cannot, because our lives are on the line. And the truth is we are living in a world where the problem is not me. The problem is not Tony Muga. The problem is not, the problem is that we don't know what the hell is going on at Fukushima, and we are being lied to. And now is the point in time when human beings who are aware of this will choose, can choose, have the opportunity to choose to be human themselves and shed light on this for us, because our lives are at stake. Tony, you have been producing a number of short, excellent videos, which are up on your WordPress site. They show up all over Facebook and YouTube. You have your YouTube channel. What are you doing now? You've done, I think, four so far. Very excellent. You ask the right questions. You are a natural detective. You're a scout. You're screwed, buddy, just like me. What are you doing next? What's on your plate coming?
Back over my book, Something Wicked This Way Comes. It's free, available on my website, and I want to put it in a PDF form where you can go page by page and, you know, stop on one page and come back the next day, because it is fairly extensive. One thing I wanted to make sure, a couple things I want to say real quick.
Sure.
In regards to the tsunami and earthquake drill that apparently occurred as the event in Fukushima, as far as that type of information goes, although I'm not a detective and an expert in pursuing it like a case, I feel on my behalf I'm responsible to the American public to at least put all information forth regardless of where it may lead and let them debunk it and let them look into it. Kind of this is what I've done, Mike, consistently with a number of these events, shootings or whatever it is, having this crazy stuff going on. I'm very opinionated. I don't deny it, but I try to just put the information out there, like you say, and I see this, there's a discrepancy here, and this is, you know, I leave it with the American public, and hopefully they come to a decision about it. And secondly, if I could clarify, because people ask me, when the president said harmless levels, how could they say harmless levels? Extensively in this documentation, they're basing their models, and the ones the president will say harmless or JAXCO will say harmless, on 4 to 5 days or 96 hours worth of emissions. And as you clearly pointed out, you know, and especially in like a China syndrome meltdown, those emissions continue and continue and continue.
Yes,
yes, they're the bolt come out initially and taper off, but they've got to model more completely. And so in those 4 to 5 days and 96-hour models, that was bunk. That was one of the ways they downplayed it and legitimized that Rose Garden speech. So those two points I just wanted to make.
Excellent. That's and what you bring up there, Tony, is to me the two most important qualities of a scout One is honor and integrity. The edge of your knife must be sharp in what you report back to the tribe, because the scout's job, as my friend Michael Mantis wrote so eloquently, is to, first of all, track. We are trackers of truth. And we have to not get to follow false trails. We have not to miss. We have to avoid misreading trails. We have to avoid being led into ambushes, and they have been laid for you as they were laid for me. We have to honestly, with honor, convey that back to the tribe, because they base their decisions on what the scouts bring back. Scouts live behind enemy lines. Scouts live way deep in the heart of the darkness. And the other is to bring back the accurate reports, and to do the best they can to get the best information into the hearts and minds of all the members of the tribe as possible. And our tribe is all 7 billion people on the planet. That's the de facto situation here. You meet and beat those standards easily, and that's why I'm extremely happy to have you on the show tonight. What kind of responses have you been getting? I know that now, especially since I picked this up belatedly, a lot more people are looking at these documents. My Facebook page went crazy. People were pulling, you know, scores of excerpts out. Well, my God, look at this one. My God, look at that one. And it was sinking in. What kind of responses are you getting right now? Are you getting any interest? Are people asking to talk to you?
Yes, and it's been a slow curve. And I don't deny, since you've looked into this, it's picking up. People are showing. Obviously, if you're looking into it, they're going to take it seriously. They don't really know me that well yet. But as time goes on, I've heard your 100th monkey thing. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's my hope. I'm like, that eventually enough of us monkeys figure out the truth about Fukushima and nuclear power. And that's like our priority right now, to shut that down. So I've gotten positive responses other than the occasional go kill yourself type email in my box or what have you. But most of the general public is, and they understand it once they dig into it. And it's such an eye-opener, because if you had preconceived notions about how fascism works, how the corporate controls the government and influences the government, you'll lose all of those when you read these documents or read what I've condensed and put together to save you the time. So,
That was the point that I was getting to, is that what I have found is that when you read and condense, you do so ethically. I have looked at many of your videos and your writings, and I haven't read the book, but you know, I've been, believe me, I've been in it, and I'm nodding my head as I listen to you ask the common sense questions. What are the big questions right now? We're down to about 7 minutes. Just take a couple of minutes. What are the big questions? What do you want to know after reading all this stuff and living with it more than the rest of us? What are the biggest questions burning in your mind?
Well, okay, and I have a question for you, and that would be that, from your experience from 9/11 and your involvement there and your writing and your work in that department, mm-hmm. and considering what happened on 9/11, would you give us any advice as the public and people trying to bring this to light? What avenue should we take now? I mean, I've written the book. Mm-hmm. I've got the documentation out there. People's taken some interest in it. And right now, like you said, I'm not sure where to go. I'm not sure what my next step will be other than to button the book up and get it in PDF form for everybody. So what do you think?
That's a great question. Damn, you're pretty good. I like you.
Thank you. This could be the beginning of a beautiful friendship, Louie.
Yeah, Louie, yeah. I like that. My long experience and the situation at present is absolutely clear that there is nothing to be gained by pursuing any governmental conventional channel to get somebody to open up, to start talking to us and addressing what's in these documents. It's my complete opinion that these documents must be used because of the probative value which they carry as self-authenticating documents. I can't say that enough. As the benchmark for what we consider the condition and the state of the Fukushima reactors to be. In other words, if you were to ask me where I would bet my life on what the most accurate description is, I would say these documents give it. Of course, they aren't recent. We don't have recent transcripts, but we know that nothing has been contained, and we know that we're being lied to. So the only avenue available to us now is to make as many people aware of this as possible and to hold the door open for anyone who wants to demonstrate and live their humanity, that we open that door and hold the space for them to come in lovingly so that we can receive them and participate with us on this side of the line, because everything is at stake right now. So exposure is the answer. Getting people to read these documents is the answer, and getting questions directed to people like Arnie, to people like Helen, to all of the women. I don't mean to single them out. Anybody who might know anything needs to come forward. This is our obligation as human beings to each other. So that was a great question. What was the question I asked you? Were you evading the question?
I think I'm trying to figure out where I'm, you know, what am I going to do from here with this thing? And you pretty much answered my.
What are your biggest questions? If you could find out one answer to a condition of anything at Fukushima right now, what would you want to know?
If I could, I would fly inside of Unit 4, and I would look around if I could withstand the rad level in there, and I'd get some real footage, and I'd hold a newspaper up with a date on it and a current event to prove it was legitimate and scan around. I mean, once they put the covers over those things, they can tell the general public what they want, and as you can see, the masses of people paying attention to mainstream, they're completely fooled by it. So I got to give them credit. They're organized. They're experienced. They're dedicated. They work hard, man. The adversaries, they know what they're doing. I give them that much. I don't like what they're doing, but I have respect for them, no doubt about it.
Well, it's wise to respect your energy, your enemy, but to me, it's abundantly clear. None of the videos being released out of Unit 4 to me are credible in any way for the exact reasons that you just described. They haven't walked the camera over inside a structure, peered over into a spent fuel pool underneath. We're getting all these clipped, edited still shots and little clips of footage, none of which establish the authenticity of what TEPCO claims to be doing now and what so much of the corporate media in the world and the national governments of the world, are all trying to shove down our throats. We know they're shoving us poison. That's what's so frustrating about this. And this is the crying need. It is not to evaluate you to evaluate me. Is we need to know what the hell's going on there. And what you have given us is absolute, incontestable, legal evidence of enormous probative value that says clearly, and these guys, you know, the New York Times has, you know, come out with spin stories. Oh, they were confused. They didn't know what they were saying. And I say, bullshit. I read the transcripts. These people are speaking unequivocally with certainty about the conditions there. There was no confusion expressed. Gee, we don't know in these documents. And I was especially, we got 1 minute left, and I was especially concerned about it came close to a presidential order to evacuate all Americans from Tokyo, and that was acknowledged very early on. So, Tony, I don't know what else to say. I was going to take a few minutes to talk at the end, but you know, I feel spent, and I feel like we've covered a lot of ground. It is my prayer that you continue to do what you're doing. You are articulate. You make great videos. Your critical thinking skills are terrific, and you are serving your fellow man. So we're at the end of the show tonight. So I just want to thank you for joining us, and I'm probably thinking we're going to have you back.
That would be excellent. Can I real quick just thank Shazam and Maureen for assistance with the FOIA documents? They did excellent work, and I wouldn't be here today with my work the way it was without their assistance. So I do thank them very much, and I thank you as well, Mr. Rupert, very, very much.
This was a pleasure. I know we did some good. Hattrick Penry, Tony Muga at hattrickpenry.wordpress.com. Finding him on Facebook as Hattie Hattrick Penry. He's around. You will not have to look hard to find him and the work he has done. your life and your children's lives depends more on you understanding what's in there than reading anything else or understanding anything else right now. This is Michael C. Rupert, Tracker of Truth. Pretty drained after this show tonight, December 1st, 2013. I will be back with you next week. Tony, thank you for being with us. Everybody, carry on. Good night.